the store chain that'll go nameless has made that big deal out of adding a set of bathrooms. Their stock has dropped drastically, the value of the company, because over a million people have said we're not going to shop there anymore. Yeah. And so Genesis chapter 12, I'm going to teach today, I'm going to teach Tuesday night, and possibly when we get back from Angola, this is something that's just stirring in me, but I'm going to teach on how to walk in the blessing. Because, beloved, that's what we're after. It's not the stuff, it's not the things, it's not the money that we're after. Now, I want to take a little time to introduce this. And the first thing that I want to say to you, I wrote this in my notes because I did not want to forget to say it. I refuse to apologize or explain to any... I refuse to apologize to anyone for the blessing that Elizabeth and I walk in.
Amen.
I refuse to hide it. I refuse to talk it down. Amen. I don't care where I am. I mean, I can go to the poorest section that I have ever been to in Angola and tell them how blessed I am.
Amen.
Tell them that God has made me rich. Now, the reason I can do that is because they can do the same thing. I'm not going to back off of that.
Amen.
I want to explain to you why we are so blessed. You know, I was talking to somebody, it's been a few years ago now, and it was after our trip home from Peru. And I've told you all the testimony, and I know I say this a lot, but, you know, these are my testimonies. And that's the reason I share them. If you'll ever listen to Papa Hagen, to Kenneth Hagen Sr., you'll hear the exact same testimony almost every time he preaches. At 17 years old, he was on his deathbed, and, you know, God showed up. And if you talk to if you listen to Lester Sumrall, he'll tell you the testimony of being on his deathbed. And so, you know, we were coming home from Peru. We got to the airport early that night, and we get there, and the line to United is out the door. And you all know the story. They told us, you're not going home tonight. Everybody at the airport said, you're not going home tonight. Your plane, see, the flight is from Houston to Lima, Peru, and then the same plane goes from Lima, Peru back to Houston. Every day it makes that flight. And they said, you're not leaving. Your plane hasn't left Houston yet because of mechanical problems. And everybody in line saying, you're not going home tonight. Every gate agent is saying, you're not going home tonight. I said, I don't care what you say, I'm going home. Now, we had a group of six. And so we wouldn't back off of that. We wouldn't I'm not going to apologize. Do I feel sorry for everybody that got left behind? I'm sorry they got left behind, but that's their problem, not mine. Now, I understand what I'm saying. If you walk in the blessing of God, do not apologize for the blessing of God that's on your life.
Amen.
If you walk in the favor of God, God is going to do things for you that He doesn't do for anybody else. And if you keep apologizing because God shows you favor, is God going to continue to show you favor? I wouldn't. If I were God and I kept doing you favors and you keep saying, hey, I'm sorry. You know, I'm sorry about that. I'm sorry that he... No. I'm going to proclaim, look, this is how good my God is. And so we watched as the guy's telling me, there's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. Sir, here's six first class tickets on Delta. I mean, the whole time he's telling me, he's typing away. That's why I'm doing this. He's typing away on his keyboard. Click, 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 click. See, sir, here's six first-class tickets on Delta. I'm not going to apologize for that. No. I'm not going to apologize for the blessing that rests in our life, but I want to teach you how to walk in the blessing. The Holy Spirit reminded me when we bought Elizabeth's car and the first time I brought it here. A couple of you took a ride in it. I didn't take you for a ride. I handed Vicky the keys. And don't tell my wife that. And I handed Vicky the keys. And so they went for a ride, and I was kind of concerned whether they were coming back or not. And I'm just kidding, because they were gone for a few minutes. But I will never forget what Vicky said, because she came back a few minutes before service started, which is nice to have people here a few minutes before service starts. But they came back a few minutes before service starts, and she joked about, you know, I'm going to take you for another ride. I don't remember how you said it. And I said, no. And she said, no, Pastor, I'm coming in there to learn how I can get this. And that's the mentality we have to have. What the devil tries to do is to turn you against people that are blessed, to turn you against people that are working it in their lives, to give you excuses for why it's easier for them than it is for you. Listen, and you all know this, we have been to the place, they've shut our utilities off, they've taken meters out of the ground, we've been with no food, so don't say, well, he had an easier start than we did, because we left everything to learn how to trust God. I gave up a good job. I gave up a company car. I gave up all my benefits, all of that to just obey God. And so let's get into this. Would you like to learn how to walk in the blessing?
Amen.
I mean, you're in a level of the blessing, but I want to go deeper. Because Pastor Callahan preached this Friday night that God's best friend. You know, I don't know how you can disagree with the prosperity message when the word is very clear that God's best friend is a multimillionaire. Abraham is the first one mentioned as a friend of God. And he was the wealthiest man around. Even after he, and we're going to get into that, even after he had left everything, God continued to prosper him. And so, Genesis chapter 12, let's look at the blessing, and then we're going to get in, and we're going to deal just with one area of how to walk in the blessing. But let's look at the blessing first, because, beloved, one of the big mistakes people make is they're going after the stuff. And I don't even mean things, I don't mean money, but they have a specific thing that they are believing God for, that they are trusting God for, and whether you'll admit it or not, you are serving God for that thing. You know, maybe you need a healing in your body. Maybe you need family salvation. Maybe you need family restoration or whatever it is. So every one of us has done it, that we've got that one specific thing that we're after, and we'll do whatever it takes to get that thing. And then when the thing comes, all of a sudden, we're not nearly as motivated. Okay. And then when that thing comes, I'm not nearly as motivated.
Amen.
Is that easy? I thought I'd get an amen out of that. That's why Paul didn't say, press toward the prize. He said, press toward the mark for the prize. What's he talking about? Learn the process. Learn what you have to do. See, beloved, in the music industry, which I have no knowledge of whatsoever, I just know a phrase. But in the music industry, it's known as a one-hit wonder. You know, you got musicians or vocalists that get one hit, and then don't do anything.
Yeah.
Another example, I mean, you see it in the sports world all the time. They were just after the big paycheck. They were just after the success. And I'm not picking on anybody, but Johnny Manziel is a perfect example. That guy has self-destructed. Could have had a long career in the NFL making multiplied millions, but all he wanted was the big payday. He got the big payday and has totally self-destructed. And we see the exact same thing in the church world. Not to that level, because we don't have many people in the church world operating at that level. So let's look at this, the blessing. Genesis chapter 12. God appears to Abram. There is no account in the Word of any relationship between God and Abram before this. It's just God chooses him. Now we know why. From the New Testament, we know why God chose Abram, because he said, you will teach your children and your children's children. So we knew he could trust him. But let's look at this. And he says, verse number 2, talking about the blessing. He says, I will make you a great nation. See, beloved, it's not just about you. God's trying to make you a great nation. Not just you, not just your immediate family, not just those immediately around you, but he wants you to be a great nation, and I will bless you. And I'll make your name great, and so you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse, and in you all families of the earth will be blessed. Now, you may say, well, Pastor, that's a promise to Abram. Now, we don't have to turn over there, but you can write it down. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 and 14 says, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse, being made a curse for us. For it is written, anyone who hangeth on a tree is cursed, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. So, we're heir to this blessing.
Right.
I want you to, I'll bless you. I'll make your name great, and so you shall be able. I'm going to be so blessed, people are going to know my name.
Amen.
You're going to be so blessed, people will. Oh, I don't want anybody to know me, Pastor. Then you're breaking covenant. Because God says, I'm going to bless you, and I will make your name great, and you'll be a blessing. But beloved, when you're a blessing, people like to see you coming.
Yeah. Amen.
When you're a blessing, servers, waiters, waitresses, restaurant owners, store owners like to see you show up because they know they're going to be a blessing to us. There's a restaurant near where we live, and we eat there quite often. I mean, they know us. They know us so well that the owner will bring out new dishes that he's trying and say, hey, I want to know what y'all think about this. We went in Friday for lunch with some friends of ours, and I told him, I called the owner over, and I said, I just want you to surprise me. I said, no, you can't ask me any questions. Just surprise me. So the owner is also the chef. He goes back in the kitchen and creates a dish. It's not on the menu. But he knows I'm a blessing to him. He knows I'm a blessing to his serving staff. We're a blessing to his restaurant. So he wants to be a blessing to us because we're a blessing to him. That's the reputation we're supposed to have.
Amen.
Not all the back and cheap Christian people. Do you know the toughest day of the week to get waiters and waitresses to work?
Sundays.
Sundays. They hate to work on Sundays because you got Christians leaving gospel tracts as their tips.
Yeah.
And I've told you all that story. We were in Cracker Barrel one day on a Saturday morning. There was a group of us that met for breakfast. And I noticed when the waitress opened her little notebook that there was one of those gospel tracts that looked like money. And I said, did somebody leave you that as a tip? She said, yeah, but they meant well. I said, no, they didn't. They're cheap. But they didn't mean well. No, it's okay. You know, and so she gave me, she was defending them. I said, no. I said, I want you to know I'm a pastor, and that makes me mad, and I'm going to make up for it. And I gave her a $100 bill.
Amen.
And she said, oh, you don't have to do that, as she closed her notebook. Started to walk away. No, but you don't do that, pastor. I want to be, you know, when I was leaving, she was chasing me out through the store area of Cracker Barrel. I need to know about your church.
Amen.
I need to know a little bit more about your church. Now, has she ever shown up? No, that's not what it's about.
No.
See, I'm not trying to build a church. I'm trying to build a kingdom.
Amen.
And I don't do ministry to try to build this church. I do ministry to build the kingdom of God. And God said, I will build the church.
Amen.
And go with me to Genesis chapter 26. Is this going to be okay?
Yes.
So that's how we're supposed to be. People should be, oh, we should have servers fighting over us to serve us. No, it's my turn. You had them last time. It's my turn to have them this time. Yeah, the restaurant, the restaurants we eat at a lot, that's how they are. No, it's our turn. We get them this time. The friends of ours who've only eaten at this restaurant once with us, got there before we did. And they, when they went to see them, they said, we just want you to know we're meeting your all's favorite people. And they said, well, what are you talking about? And told them who he was talking about. They go, oh, yeah, we like when they come in. That should be our reputation. I'm blessed, and I am a blessing.
Amen.
So you go to Genesis chapter 26, and let's go down to verse number 2. We're talking about Isaac now. We looked at the blessing on Abraham. Now this blessing has been transferred or passed down to Isaac. See, but if you understand, the Bible says don't be ignorant of Satan's devices.
Right.
Isn't it interesting? Now listen, if you disagree with me, that's fine. If you think what I'm going to say is wrong, that's fine. But if you agree with me, I want you to at least grunt. Okay? Isn't it interesting how much the devil works to separate you from me?
Amen.
Amen.
Isn't that interesting?
Yes.
Isn't it interesting how upset you get at me? Mm-hmm. I appreciate no amens on that one. Yeah, honey, thanks. The only amen I got was from my wife.
Yeah, you better believe it. I gotta sleep with the guy.
We have the same bed. Isn't that interesting? Because Abraham, as the father of this family, can we compare it to being the spiritual father, had the blessing on his life passed down to the son that was under him? Because in the kingdom of God, that's how it operates.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying you're not getting my blessing. I'm keeping my blessing. But you can tap into this. Paul said to the church at Philippi, because you've partnered with me, you're a partaker. You are a partner also in my grace. Everything that's on my life, you now have access to. And it's why the devil works so hard to get you out of here. To get you distracted from here. You know, I'm just going to tell you my belief on it. I'm dogmatic about it. I know people have different beliefs. I believe the word is very clear. Paul told, I think it's the church at Corinth. He told the church at Corinth, he says, you have many teachers, but you have one Father. Now, there's a lot of people that have the mentality, have the belief that, well, I can have many spiritual fathers. You know, this is my father in the prophetic. This is my father in healing. This is my father in evangelism. That's not what the word says. The word says you have but one father. And now you can have, we can equate that to in the natural, in the physical, that you may have, and I'm just coining somebody else's term. I mean, a person may have, and I apologize, but I don't know another a better way to illustrate it. You may have someone that was a sperm donor. But they're not your father.
Right.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
I mean, you may have adopted a child, and you're more of a father to them than the father that fathered them is. Right. And so your spiritual father is not the person necessarily you were born again under.
Right. Amen.
Because Paul called himself a spiritual father to many, mm-hmm. and they didn't get born again under him. He just brought them in as his, and it's the devil works because there is a spiritual truth of the blessing passing from generation to generation, and the devil wants to get you out of the place you're supposed to be to stop the transfer of that blessing. And you may say, well, Pastor, I don't want what's on your life. Then you're in the wrong place. Look, I don't have a problem with that. If you don't want what I have, I don't understand why you're here. Well, it's just convenient. It's the closest church. Y'all are like, seriously? But there's people that choose that way.
Yes.
My son-in-law, our son-in-law, he's married to our daughter, our son-in-law used to work with somebody that was so proud. They couldn't believe that Jason and Christian drove 25 to 30 minutes to get to church. He said, that's nothing. My mother and father-in-law drive 2 hours. And they were so proud of the fact that they could get from their driveway to the church in 3.5 minutes. Now, they're not being taught anything. They're not being changed, but at least it's convenient. We don't eat that way. We don't try to find a restaurant that way. One of Elizabeth's favorite places is one of them frou-frou places called the Glitz. Now, it's 30 minutes from our house in a place called None Such Kentucky. Now that ought to tell you something. None Such. Would you like to know what none is in None Such?
Nothing.
The Glitz, that's about it. But you got to get a reservation to go eat there. Because people know what's there. They know it's worth coming for. Okay, so I wanted to deal with that because the devil's going to work so, and he'll do it subtly. You know better than, you know, for him to come and tell you to leave, but he'll bring distractions to try to pull you out.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's where, anyway, okay, Genesis chapter 26. The Lord appeared to him unto Isaac and said, don't go down to Egypt. Stay in the land of which I shall tell you. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with you and bless you. I'll be with you. And I'll bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands, and I will establish the oath which I swore to your father Abraham. I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven, and will give your descendants all these lands, and by your descendants all the nation of the earth shall be blessed. Now, go to Genesis chapter 13. So the same blessing, and we know there in Genesis chapter 26, we may get there later, but we know in that chapter, God says, look, Isaac, don't go there. Stay here. Well, if you go back and look at verse number 1, it says it was a famine. We're not just talking about a drought. It's gone past no rain. It's gone past drought. And now it's into famine. Everything is dying. And God tells Isaac, sow in this land, because I've blessed you. Now, can you imagine how ridiculous Isaac feels? But when you understand the blessing, when you understand how the blessing of God works, you're not looking at circumstances. Beloved, I don't care what people think about me. I am more concerned about the blessing of God being on my life because I've seen the results that come with the blessing. If I'm concerned about people's opinion, I'm not going to walk in the blessing. If I'm concerned about whether people like me or not, I'm not going to walk in the blessing, because the longer and deeper you get in the blessing of God, you're going to have people who don't like you.
Yeah.
It amazes me. I have no idea what any other church or ministry in Eastern Kentucky is doing. I don't care. But isn't it interesting how many of them are convinced they know what we're doing?
Yeah.
And they're convinced they know me. I mean, I'm not naming any names, but I was on a local Christian television station. And the way they talked about me was unbelievable. Where Trish used to work, they told her, don't go to church down there, he'll garnish your wages. I mean, it's just a mate, but I don't care. Because when you walk in the blessing, people have to give themselves an excuse for why it's not working for them. You know, he's so blessed because he's stealing so much money out of the church. That's my favorite. Mm-hmm. You know, our offering was like $7, $8, and that was huge. But I'm stealing all the money. Yeah, and I bought a blizzard on the way home. That's it. Now, go with me. Genesis chapter 13. In verse number 2, remember we read earlier that Abram was blessed. God placed his blessing on Abram.
Yeah.
And it says here in verse number 2, now Abram was
rich.
Now rich is good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, rich is good. I mean, most people be happy with rich, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I want some help out with the Hebrew language here. I want some help out with the English language. Which is better, rich or very rich?
Very rich.
Okay, I just want to make sure I'm right, because God says he was very rich. The world today would call it filthy rich.
Yeah.
We don't believe in filthy rich.
Yeah.
I don't. Rich is rich. Yeah. And very rich. And just in case some theologians that are a lot more intelligent than any of us would like to argue about it, God wants to explain what he means by very rich. In cattle, in silver, and in gold. Now, I'm more than happy to be rich in silver, but I don't want to have to store that much. Because if you're going to be rich in silver, you know, people are saying right now, buy up silver, buy up silver, buy up silver. You better own some warehouses to keep enough to make it any good to you. But now gold? I'm not telling you I'm turning down silver. I mean, Solomon got so wealthy, he didn't have time to count the silver. He had full-time, what we would call accountants, that worked, 100 accountants that worked for him full-time and did nothing but count his money, and they didn't have time to get to the silver. And can you imagine what people would say if you came into my house and go out my backyard? What's all that, Pastor? Oh, that's all the coins. I ain't got time to fool them. So I just got big piles out in my backyard. There's silver dollars. There's half dollars. There's $10. There's just, you know, you need some, back your truck up, take what you need. I ain't got time to fool with that. That's where he was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold. Now go down to verse number 5. Abram so understood the blessing. This was one of my favorite accounts to help explain an understanding of the blessing. It says verse number 5. And Lot, who went with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents, and the land could not sustain them while dwelling together. That's some rich. You know you're rich when the land can't handle how wealthy you really are. For their possessions were so great, they were not able to remain together. Verse 7. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. Now the Canaanite and the Perizzite were dwelling then in the land. Isn't that interesting that it brings out the Canaanite and the Perizzite were there too? You see, when I can't, God said, don't even associate with these people. But they're in the land where they are, and it brought strife. Verse 8, so Abram said to Lot, please let there be no strife between you and me, nor between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we're brothers. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If to the left, then I will go to the right. Or if to the right, then I will go to the left. Now, if you don't understand the blessing, and you're getting ready to divide property, wouldn't you want to choose first?
Amen.
But when you understand the blessing, it don't matter. Abram knew wherever he went, the blessing of the Lord was on him. And so look at what happens. He says, you choose to the right, I'll go to the left. You choose the left, I'll go to the right. I don't care. I mean, Lot must have thought he won the lottery. Yeah. I get to choose. But you see where Lot's heart was. Because he chose toward Sodom and Gomorrah. That's like you get to choose anywhere in the United States and you choose Las Vegas. Yep. There's a lot of money there, Pastor. Got a lot of sin there, too. Yep. And so he says, Lot lifted his eyes and saw the valley of Jordan. It was well watered everywhere. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, God wants to point out. I want you to see where he's looking. Like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as you go to Zoar. Verse 11. So Lot chose for himself all the valley of the Jordan, and Lot journeyed eastward. They were separated from each other. Abram settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled in the valleys of the cities of the valley and moved his tents as far as Sodom. It didn't matter to Abram. See, look, when you understand the blessing, all you are concerned about is obeying God. That's it, when you understand the blessing. Because I'm not trying to figure out how God's going to do it. I'm not trying to figure out the best plan. I figured out the best plan. It saves me a lot of trouble. Just find out God's plan and fulfill it.
Amen.
I mean, you all know that. And again, I'm going to apologize for my testimonies.
Amen.
But 2 years ago when I was in Angola, this is before Elizabeth went with me, I'm still trying to convince her Angola is a vacation because it's nothing but beach. There is an ocean. And there's beach, but she still wants to go to the beach for anyway. And so I get up to, I'm supposed to preach Sunday morning. I know God's told me to go there to preach. And the pastor tells me I'll pick you up at 7:30 in the morning. He doesn't show up till 9:30. And I'm sitting in the lobby for 2 hours. I'm mad. I'm beyond angry. There's another word I'd like to use, but it wouldn't be appropriate. And I'm not going. And when the other pastors came down at 9 o'clock, they're laughing at me. And I said, I'm not going. I'm going back to my room. If I'm their only chance to get to heaven, they're all going to hell. Because I ain't going. Mm-hmm. And then just out of here, the Holy Spirit says, you're here for the people. Mm-hmm. And I went because God told me to go. And I'm telling you, out of that has been major blessing into our lives. Because I obeyed God. And I'm getting ahead of myself because I obeyed God and did what he told me to do. Now, go with me to Genesis. Let's keep going here. So let's get back to this. Abram and Lot have separated. He let Lot choose first. And Lot, the Bible makes it very clear that Lot picked out the best. But Abram understood the blessing. I want to get back to this. When you understand the blessing, you're not trying, and I want you to understand the word I'm using. You're not trying to connive to get the best for you. Right. You're not trying to make things happen for you. It's amazing how many people ask me, Pastor, how do you get all these invitations? How do you get all these places to preach? Mm-hmm. I mean, even to the point, a few years ago, I had somebody call me and they said, hey, we want you to come back. We're sorry we haven't had you come preach here in a while. We want to schedule you. We're excited about it. We want you for the weekend. We love you and Elizabeth, and we want you to come and minister to our people and minister to us. And so they said, here's the time. We know it's short notice, but can you make it? And I looked. I said, let me check my calendar. I'll call you back. So I checked the calendar. We've got the date set. I called him back the next day. I said, look, we've got it set. We're ready to come. And we're excited about it. We have those dates open. He said, oh, praise God. We've written it in. We're so excited about you coming. By the way, how do you get all these places to preach in Europe? Do you have a lot of contacts in Europe? And I said, well, yeah. You know, every place I preach, they want me back. Well, how could I get in touch with all of them? And I said, you can't. Not through me. I don't do that. Those people trust me. Those people have opened themselves, they've opened their people, they've opened their church to me. I'm not afraid. Understand, I'm not afraid. Well, you're just afraid somebody else will go in, they'll like them better. That's not it at all. I protect where I minister. I protect the pastors. I protect the people. And I said, I'm sorry. I said, I don't do that. And, well, how did you get those contacts? I said, God has opened the door. I said, that's my only explanation. And so they tried a few times. I said, look, I'm sorry, but I can't do that. That is not me. Okay, well, I understand. And then the next day I get a text from them. We're sorry, our schedule's full, and we're not interested in having you in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, y'all think I live this, you know, pie in the sky. Well, Pastor, you have no idea what I'm going through. And have never, that was probably 5 or 6 years ago, and have never heard from them again. Pastor, how do you get all these places to preach? I'm concerned about the blessing of the Lord. If God would tell me today, I do not want you traveling anymore, I'd be done. I wouldn't go anywhere. I listen to him every place we go, every door that opens. If it's a God thing, I'm going, because I found out if God says to go, then he'll pay. When God doesn't say to go, I got to figure it out. And so now you go down here. So Abram has Lot, you choose first. It doesn't matter what. You give me the sand. You give me the worst land, the rockiest land. The blessing of the Lord has made me rich. Do you remember? And we're gonna see that. We may get there today. But Abram so understood the blessing. Do you remember when they came? The king came, and the king of Sodom came and took, not the king of Sodom. The king came and took Lot and all his family after he attacked. And Abram went and got over 300 of his own servants born in his house, trained for war, and got all of it back. And the king said, you can have all the stuff. I just want the people. And Abram said, I'm not even going to accept a shoestring from you, lest you can say you've made me rich.
Amen.
Abram so understood the blessing. He didn't just take it from anybody. He said, no. God is the one that's my source.
Amen.
God is the one that takes care of me.
Amen.
God, and I'm not going to let any man take the credit. Well, I made him rich. I'm the one that sustains him. I'm not going to let that happen in my life. I don't let, if people sow to me, it doesn't give them special favors with me.
No.
You're not going to buy me.
No.
When we first started, Elizabeth and I had just left our jobs. We just stepped out in faith. I had somebody call me. And I'm telling you what, we needed every penny. Because we had nothing. And they called me up and they said, hey, if we wanted to support you in what you're doing and we wanted to get money to you, would we send it to the church or would we send it to you? Now the truth is, beloved, if you're truly wanting to get seed into somebody, you're not, what's the best way I can do it? Send it to me.
Amen.
And they said, do we send it to the church, market for you? Do we send it to you? And I said, look, if you are sending money to me because you feel sorry for me and you think I need it, then keep it. I don't want your money. But now if God has spoken to you and you believe in what I'm doing and he's laid it on your heart to support us, then you can send it to me. You can send it to the church. It doesn't matter. It'll get to me. Would you like to know how much they sent? Not a thing. Never send anything. And, well, Pastor, you must not have needed it. Oh, you have no idea how much we needed it. But I'm not going to allow that. And that's what Abram said. Look, I understand the blessing. And I'm not going to let you say I made him rich. And so Abram so understood it. Verse number 14, Genesis chapter 13. The Lord said to Abram after Lot had separated from him. I love this. I'm telling you, this is when you understand the blessing. It says, now lift up your eyes and look from the place where you are. Now notice this. Which direction does God tell Abram to look? All four. To the north, to the south, to the east, and to the west. Do you understand what that means? Well, let's finish this. Then we'll go back and understand what it means. For all, verse 15, for all the land which you see, I will give it to you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants of the dust of the earth, so that if anyone can number the dust of the earth, then your descendants can also be numbered. Do you understand you and I are fulfillment of that prophecy? Arise, walk about the land through its length and breadth, for I will give it to you. Then Abram moved his tent, but understand. So here, he so understands the blessing of God that's on his life, he lets Lot choose first. And then because Abram showed his trust in God and in the blessing, now, do you understand, Abram and Lot are standing together. And Abram says, if you choose to the right, I'll go to the left. If you choose the left, I'll go to the right. So Lot chooses and then goes off to his land. Abram's still standing in the same place. Now God says, look to the north, to the south, to the east, to the west, and all of its land I've given you. Do you understand what that means? That was Lot's land too. That was all included in that. And God said, I've given it all to you because you trust me. See, beloved, I'm not concerned about what people do. I'm not concerned about people that have done me wrong. I'm not concerned about people that gave and then stopped giving or whatever it is. Because God says, look, you trust in the blessing? I'm going to take care of all that. I'm going to cover all that for you. Because people are my source. People aren't your source. Your job's not your source. Your education's not your source. Praise God for all of those things. But if you trust in the blessing, God's not limited on what he can get to you. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 11. Deuteronomy chapter 11. Lord, that's the blessing I want all my life and I want to increase in. That it doesn't matter. I mean, God can send us to one of the poorest areas in the world that I've ever seen and bless us abundantly just for obeying him. Yeah. I mean, that first trip that we went, and I said, yeah, I'll be there. And then I looked up how much it cost. I was like, oh my God, what have I done? If I'd have thought in the natural mind, I would have given an explanation. Well, you know, I got ahead of myself there, and I don't know if it's God or not. Let me pray about this, and let me see if I can raise some money. Won't you help me? You know, when I ask people if they want to receive my email that we send out when we travel, I tell them, if you ever get an email from me that asks for money, number one, no, it's not me. Because I never will. I don't know if I put myself in a corner like that pastor. No, I know what God has spoken to me. I'm not a fundraiser. I'm not trying to raise funds.
Amen.
I mention to people. I have to get better at it. You know, Elizabeth, she pushes me in. I have a tough time talking about me. And I know people don't think that. I know people think I'm proud, I'm haughty, I'm confident in who I am, but I have a tough time talking about myself. If I try to sell my books, I'm terrible at it. Hey, I wrote a book. You want one? Buy it. You don't? I don't care. I already paid for them. That's my sales pitch. It was so bad in Illinois last year. Pastor Bob's wife, Debbie, Pastor Debbie came up and said, can I sell your book for you? She said, you're awful at it. When I talk about becoming partners with you, when I talk about becoming partners with us, it's me. I have a difficult time. Look, God's going to take care of me.
Amen.
But I found out my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge if they don't know. You'll never hear me bawl and squall and cry for money. You'll never know. You won't know. You'll hear testimonies after it's over. But we're not going to talk about it in the middle of it. As just extra, and some may want to grab it. Verse number 26 of Deuteronomy chapter 11. Talking about how to walk in the blessing. See, I'm setting before you today a blessing and a curse. the blessing. If you listen to the commandments of the Lord your God, which I'm commanding you today. Now go to Deuteronomy chapter 28. See, beloved, when you begin to understand, and I'm not telling you I'm an expert at it, but when you begin to understand how the kingdom of God operates, then you begin to understand the underlying or the behind-the-scenes reason for why the devil does the things that he does. Now, let me explain what I'm talking about, and I've taught you this before. It's like the attack that we have right now against tithing. I mean, there's an out-and-out attack in the church world about tithing.
Yes.
You don't have to. It's Old Testament. Murder's Old Testament, but it's still wrong. Murder's under the law, but we're still not supposed to. Isn't that funny? That the one thing that the devil is truly attacking is tithing. And it's not about the money. Understand, beloved, the finances of this church, it's our giving that take. Now, understand, God uses your tithe and your seed to bring it in. But how we do is based on our faith and our giving.
Right.
Our church tithes. Our church sows seed. It amazes me when I look monthly to see how much we give away as a church. We have 5 different ministries that we support monthly. We support missions in Africa. Some of you know her. Many of you would know her if you saw her. But Erica Jones is a missionary to South Africa. And we support her monthly. And we support the ministries that have sown into my life. We support Jerry Seville, Bill Winston, Pastor Callahan, and John Paul. In India. I mean, that's how we're taken care of here. But the reason that, if you understand the reason the devil's after the tithe, it's not about the money, ultimately.
Right.
Because Malachi chapter 3 says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse that there may be meat in my house. I mean, that's what the tithe is for, is to meet the needs of the local body, of the local church.
Right.
But it says, see if I will not open you the windows of heaven. Have you figured out, have you been in this long enough that God's not raining down money from heaven?
Right.
So it's not talking about the money. Mm-mm. But he says, I'm going to open the windows and pour out a blessing. But see, the windows of heaven is where revelation, when you open the blinds, if we would open these blinds right now, I know it's cloudy. If it was a sunny day outside and we would open these blinds, light would come in. Then if we would go ahead and open the windows, what's outside is allowed now to come in. And if the windows of heaven are open above you, it allows light to come in and what's in heaven to come in. The blessing. So if the devil can get you to stop tithing, the windows of heaven are closed. And if you understand, if that window's closed, what's outside can't come in? That is ultimately what the devil is after. See, if he can cut off revelation knowledge from you, I can teach you anything.
Yeah.
I can now, I'm not teaching you spirit man to spirit man. I'm now teaching you soul to soul. I'm going to give you something that makes sense. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you some funny stories and some, you know, life, whatever you want to call them, because now I'm just talking mind to mind. But you're a tither and the windows of heaven are open. You're receiving revelation from God that's going to change you for eternity. That's what Satan's after. Now, Deuteronomy chapter 28. Let's go down to verse number 8. Still talking about the blessing. I don't know about anybody else, but I'm enjoying myself. I tell you what, I love this. I love walking in the blessing of God. I love it when God does things for me he doesn't do for anybody else. I love it. I mean, when, you know, we had that trip home from Peru last week. Or a couple weeks ago, where our flight was diverted to New Orleans, and I mean, thousands of people in the New Orleans airport spending the night in the New Orleans airport because there was no hotels, no rental cars, nothing. And as I step up to the check-in for Delta, United tells me, "You're on the plane. I've got your 4 seats. Just check your bags and get on the plane." You can say it's our status. You can explain it away all you want. But there was a whole lot of people that probably had higher status than I did that spent the night in the New Orleans airport. I like the blessing of God on my life.
Amen.
And so Deuteronomy chapter 11, or chapter 28, verse number 8, he says, the Lord will command the blessing upon you. I like that. It's not just like that God just goes, get it, you know, throws it out to you. He says, has God ever commanded something and it not come to pass?
No.
No.
Well, you're partially right. Because, and I'm leading into where I'm going, has God ever commanded you to do something and you didn't?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to throw that out there. I knew that'd bless you. The Lord will command the blessing upon you in your barns and in all that you put your hand to. He will bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. Verse 9, the Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself as he swore to you. So what brings this blessing into my life? No, really, I'm asking because I have no idea. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, well, here he says in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 8, 9, and 10, look, I'm going to command, verses 8 and 9, I'm going to command a blessing on you. Your land's going to be blessed. I'm going to command the blessing on your life. And then verse 10, he tells us, here's how. So this is what I want to deal with today. How do I walk in the blessing? Look at what he says. He says, verse 9, the Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself as he swore to you, if, that's a big if. Love it, look, if you want to walk in the blessing of God, you are no longer your own. That's what Paul said, I'm not my own, I'm bought with a price. And he says, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. Look, you're not going to walk in the blessing if you don't obey God.
Right.
This idea that it doesn't matter what I do now that I'm saved. Sure, try it. Hope it works. I'd hate to get to the end of my life and find out, you know what? I might have done, might have should have done a little bit more. Good Lord, what have y'all done? I mean, not that my English was any good before, but... He says, if you'll keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways, so all the people of the earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they'll be afraid of you. See, beloved, when you understand the blessing, like I said earlier, you're not concerned about what people think about you. Can you imagine Isaac? It's famine. Everything is dying or dead, and he's out there putting seed in the ground. And you know his neighbors are like, what in the world? That man's crazy. Doesn't he know? Now, and I've said this before, I don't know how God did it. I just have this idea that it would just rain on Isaac's property. Hey, couldn't that be cool? I mean, your neighbors don't think it's cool, but I mean, you're sitting there looking out, you're sitting on your front porch, and your field is barren, it's dry, and you look over at Isaac's property, and there's a perfectly shaped storm cloud just over his land. No storm. Rain cloud. At the perfect time. And they make, I bet they come up with every kind of explanation. Here's aliens. It amazes me how people think. We were getting ready to go one of the nights this week, and I turned on the television, it was on History Channel. And they did this special about Tesla, an inventor in the late 1800s. And really brought electricity to the common man. And he was working on a project for wireless electrical transfer. Now, some of the top minds in the world are working on it right now, and the furthest they can get wire, like charging station, the furthest they can get it to go is 7 feet to charge. Tesla did an experiment in the early 1900s that he had wireless electricity over 4 miles. Well. They still don't know how he's done it. And so, you know, they're talking about his experiments, and bottom line, he had come up with this experiment where he made this huge tower, but he had lied to J.P. Morgan, his number one investor, and told them he was building a radio station. And when Morgan found out he was building up a wireless electrical system to give electricity away, he cut off his funding, which, you know, Morgan's an investor, you're not going to make any money on something that's free. Whether you like it or not, that's capitalism, and we like capitalism.
Amen.
You're not very. We don't like socialism. Okay, just let me help you. When somebody gets up and says, we're going to give free education to everybody, nothing is free. Somebody pays for it. There's no such thing as free health care. Somebody's paying for it. And there's no such, anyway, that went well. But this guy was a genius. Tesla was a genius. And I started listening to these scientists explain, modern-day scientists explain, they said Tesla, when it was like he was downloading 3D holographic images, and then he would just build what he saw. And would you like to know what some of the top scientists in the world, their explanation was? It is obvious he is downloading information from alien beings. And a rabbi came on. A science, I don't remember what his title was, and said he is receiving it from aliens, it's obvious, which is the same way that Old Testament prophets received theirs. Oh. And people are like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I believe that. But you tell them, God said. Oh, come on now, don't be crazy.
Yeah.
You go out in a time of famine and you're sowing seed, understanding the blessing of God, and they'll say you're crazy. But stand up as a scientist and say, well, I'm downloading information from an alien being. If these aliens are so smart, I'm trying to use the right word, but then why are they taking the dumbest hillbillies on the planet and taking them back to their ship? They proved me. Something's wrong. Anyway, go to Genesis chapter 12. I know, honey, you love me. Anybody else ever notice that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You don't find some, you know, investment banker that's a billionaire going, I was abducted by aliens and they probed my mind. They find the guy living in his truck. Please tell me, no one here has ever been abducted by aliens and been probed. Y'all look at me like you're talking about me, Pastor. Now hold on.
Now that you mentioned it.
So that's what brings the blessing in my life. The number one thing that I want to deal with and finish it up with today is obedience brings the blessing.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says, James makes the comparison and says, if you as an earthly father know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more your heavenly father? You know the scripture that I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Now, the way we normally look at that is, if we know how to be a blessing to our kids, then how much more our Heavenly Father? But can we look at that a little bit different way? See, I'm going to tell you Pastor Jim's opinion. If you disagree with me, that's fine. But what makes, I'm not saying I'm perfect. I'm not saying, I am saying Elizabeth's perfect, but I'm not saying that I'm perfect. But I think I'm a pretty good dad. And if I, as a good earthly dad, know how and know how not to bless my children. If I will bless my kids no matter what they do, I am not a good dad. That's the problem we have with the generation coming up, is they have the mentality of everybody owes me because they're getting everything they want regardless of their actions. And they have that mentality, you owe me, you have it, I don't, so give it to me. Where did that come from? So if I know how to bless my children, that makes me a good earthly dad. And I also know when not to bless my children. And when would I bless them? I'm going to bless them when they obey me. I'm going to bless them when they please me. I'm going to bless them when they show affection for me. You know, you come to me, and it doesn't happen with our kids. I'm being totally honest. But you come to me as a kid, and you chew me out, and you talk about me like a dog. Do you really think I'm going to bless you? You're still my kid. Maybe. But we got this mentality in the religious world that God loves you no matter what you do. Yes, He does. But the verb form of that word agape, agapeo, is He wants to show His love to you. And if you don't obey Him, if you don't please Him, if you don't worship Him, He can't show that love to you. You want to walk in the blessing. Look, love, it doesn't get any more basic than this. Genesis chapter 12 and verse number 1. I'm a blessed man. We're a blessed couple. Our kids are blessed. Our grandkids are blessed. And I'm going to tell you, the number one reason we are is because we'll obey God. All I have ever wanted to do was to please God since I've been born again. Beloved, y'all know the story. I got saved, and I didn't get a welcome to the family from God. I didn't get a I love you. I got, you marry that woman. That's the first thing God ever said to me. I'm 19 years old. I've just been delivered from drugs and alcohol. I've just been delivered from suicide. I'm working at a restaurant part-time, going to school full-time, and God says, you marry that woman. I didn't argue with him. I didn't give him all the excuses for why I couldn't. I just got up from the altar, got in my car, drove to the house, knocked on her door, said, God spoke to me, I got saved tonight, we're getting married, see ya. Got back in my car, and that's 31 years ago. And from the day I got saved, please, I'm not talking about anybody. I'm talking about me. I don't understand people that don't want to please God. No. I don't understand people that are more concerned about what they want than what God wants and then don't understand why God's not blessing them. Well, Pastor, you know, this is what I'm doing this over here. Did God tell you to do that? No, it's just what I want to do, and I'm asking God to bless it. It doesn't work that way. Mm. I mean, I wouldn't do that to my kids. Hey, I want you to paint the kitchen. Okay. I realized the garage was easier, so I painted it, Dad. Okay, I'll bless you anyway. Thank you. No, I didn't want the garage painted. I wanted the kitchen painted. Well, that was hard. Got to go all around the cabinets and counters, and I just didn't want to do that, so I found something that was easier. Let's say you hired a plumber to come in because your bathroom was stopped up. Now, that's a problem. And so the plumber gets there, and he looks at it, and I'm not going to say that. And he looks at it, and it's a tough job to fix. So, you know, he comes back, and he hands you the bill, and he says, you know what? I know you brought me here to fix that toilet, but that was too difficult. But your kitchen sink is working great. Are you going to pay him?
No.
A couple years ago, our air conditioner stopped working at our house. And I don't know why I did it. I didn't ask God. That's why I did it. I called a different company than what we normally use, what we use at the church. I've done business with these people for 20 years. And I don't know, it was like I had a hit of stupid. I thought, well, I'm going to use a local company there for sales. And I called them up, and they come and look at the system. And he comes, and he gives me a bill for $125 for looking at it. And then he says, your system is shot. I mean, it is full of holes. The heat pump outside is full of holes. The air handler underneath the house is full of holes. And here's the bill. It'll be like $5,400 to replace it. Well, this was, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago. We didn't have money to do that. And so we did have money to buy window units. So we went and bought two window units, and we put one in the front of the house, one in the back of the house, and we just made do. We had fans, we did all that kind of stuff. And then I knew I had missed God by calling that company. And the Holy Spirit said, call the other guys. I'm like, Lord, I mean, it's $5,400 now. And so he said, just call the other company. So I called him. The guy stops at my house. We're not home. And he calls me, and he said, Jim, this is, you know, told me what his name was, and I know him. We've done business together before. He said, what would you say if I said I could fix your system for $200? I said, after I kissed you or not? He said, well, I said, I'm just kidding. I said, I'd tell you to fix it. He said, good, because it's already done and your system's up and running again.
Amen.
And I said, do you mind me asking, what was wrong? He said, well, last winter we had that ice storm, he said, your fan was so covered in ice, when it spun up, it broke it off. And when it broke it off, it broke part of the coil, the copper coil inside your unit. He said, all I did was fix that up, filled it with Freon, $200. Now, not listening to God almost cost me $5,200. But obeying God puts me in the place to walk in the blessing, and the blessing of the Lord does what?
Makes
me rich and adds no sorrow with it. So the first key, if you're going to walk in the blessing, is you've got to obey God no matter what.
Amen.
Go to 1 Kings chapter 17. And look, it's not difficult. It's difficult when you first start because it's doing things you don't want to do. Because human nature is, we will take the path of least resistance. Now look, it's been about a month now. 2 years ago, I was running every day and got up to the place that I was running 6 miles. And one day, I love telling the story, I was running through the neighborhood and there was these two older ladies. It's amazing how older ladies age keeps getting older as I mature. But there were these two older ladies walking through our neighborhood, and I passed them twice as I was running. And so finally, I'm running towards them. They go, excuse me, excuse me. And so, I'm not stopping. I put my headphones on. I said, yeah. And they go, sir, if you don't mind me asking, how far do you run? I said, well, I'm on my fourth mile now. That's just stupid. And then they just took off walking. Now, it's another funny story. When I run, I wear compression sleeves on my shins. It helps not hurt from shin splints. But it does look funny. I'll be honest with you. Because I got shorts come down to here. And then what look like black dress socks up to my knees. And then a little space where my ankle is. And then my running shoes. And so the other day I was running and the neighbor behind our house was pushing her trash out to the corner in her pajamas. And I couldn't help it. I pulled my headphones out. I stopped and I said, Jackie, I said, you didn't have to get all dressed up for me. She said, a man running in shorts and black socks ought not say anything. But about a month ago, I'd gotten out of the habit. I've started running again. And I've got all different routes through our neighborhood. I can run 1 mile. I can run a half a mile. I can run a mile. I can do 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 miles. I know the exact route to take. And so I started running. I couldn't make it the mile without stopping. Man, I was frustrated. I'm used to running 4, 5, and 6 miles, and I can't make it a mile without stopping. And I don't want to do this. And the Lord said, run as far as you can, and then walk the rest of it. And so I did that. And every morning when I get up, I'm not telling you, I go, no, Lord, yeah, the Lord has said, how far, I there's a knowing on the inside of me of where to run and how far to run. And it's amazing, even in something as simple as that, as I will obey God, the blessing comes on me, and just in a couple weeks, going from I can't make it a mile without stopping to where Friday ran 2.5 miles. And I don't mean running 2.5 miles in an hour and a half. Elizabeth was telling somebody last week, they said, he says, yeah, I'm going to go run. And it's like 2 or 3 minutes later, he's back in the house. Now, it's not 2 or 3 minutes. I'm not running that fast. But I'm talking like 9.5-minute miles. Just obeying God. And I found out if I'll just do what God tells me to do, then he'll put his blessing, he'll put his super on my natural, and I can do the supernatural.
Amen.
He'll do the same thing in your finances.
Amen.
But how many times does God lay it on our heart to sow something or even to do something financially, and we talk ourselves out of it, and it stops the blessing from working in our lives?
Yeah.
Because if I'm, as a good father, know how to give good gifts, I know how to bless my children when they obey me, how much more my Heavenly Father?
Yeah.
And maybe that, not maybe, that is what cuts off the supernatural financial flow to us, because God's not going to put his blessing on disobedience.
Amen.
1 Kings chapter 17. Can you take just a little bit more?
Yes.
Beloved, I understand this is coming across. I can't tell you how many times Elizabeth and I would go to meetings in Atlanta, you know, Bobby Jean's meetings, for no other reason than God told us to. No money. I mean, you know, we would get in, we would pay for the hotel room, and we would scrimp and save and scratch and pull and believe God as much as we knew how, and we were, because we knew we were supposed to be there. And those meetings 20 some years ago made a mark on our lives, and I know it's the reason we're where we are now. Look, look, I'm gonna be careful how I say it, but I want to know. And I'm talking to everybody. I know people watch Periscope. I know they watch on YouTube. We got people around the world that follow us. But I want to know, where's the next generation?
Amen.
Where is the next generation that just says, God, I'll do whatever you tell me to do? I don't care how inconvenient it is. I don't care how much it puts me out. I don't care if it takes the last dime that I have at the moment. I am going to obey you. And that's the one God says, I can put my blessing on them because I can trust them.
Amen.
I'm not telling you we've arrived. We haven't. We haven't perfected this. But if people would ask me, what's the one thing that you have done that has gotten you to the place where you are? I've obeyed God. That's it. I will do what he tells me to do. When the Lord spoke to me, I mean, I don't know how. I have people get mad at me. People get offended at me. People stop giving to me. Because, just in this one area, because the number of watches that I have given away. I don't even know anymore. I've lost count. I do not know how many watches I have given away. But I'm telling you what, beloved, every week, last week during the financial conference, people would come up and say, let me see the watch you're wearing now. What watch are you wearing today? Wear a different one every day. I could wear a different one every day for about 2 weeks. And not cheap watches. And every time, God keeps increasing what he's bringing back to me. I mean, I started out giving away, you know, $20, $30 Timexes. And then watches worth a few hundred dollars. And now, all I want is to obey God. That's it. You know, when the Lord brought that second motorcycle to me, everybody wanted to know, what are you doing with that other one? Keeping it. Why do you need two? Because I can.
Right.
Amen. Now I got three.
Amen.
Fourth one on its way.
Amen.
I can't help it. It works. Look, if I give money away, what do I get?
Money.
If I give clothes away, what do I get?
Clothes.
If I give shoes away.
Shoes.
Lord have mercy. We were getting ready to go to Illinois. And I'm packing. I go up in my closet and I pull out a box. And I go, I forgot I had these shoes. I like these. It was like Christmas all over.
Brand new.
Hadn't been worn. I thought, praise God. Where did I get these? But I give shoes away. It is bad. I admit it. I'm not trying to get over it. 1 Kings chapter 17. People came up last week. They wanted to see what watch I was wearing and what shoes I was wearing. I'm just glad I haven't given underwear away. 1 Kings chapter 17, and let's go to verse number 2. Obedience is what brings the blessing. I'll never do that. That's not right. Y'all remember that? Remember who here was at the lodge? Getting mad at my kids because they're giggling and snickering all through praise and worship. And finally they go, Daddy, look. And over in the corner is a box that says bras and panties, 50 cents. We've had some tough times, but we ain't never been so broke to buy underwear at the yard sale. No, that ain't happening. 1 Kings chapter 17, and look at verse number 2. Obedience will bring and maintain and increase the blessing because God sees that he can trust you. The word of the Lord came to him saying, unto Elijah, go away from here and turn eastward and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. It shall be that you will drink of the brook. And look at this. I have commanded the ravens to provide for you there. Now, my favorite area, this is verse number 7. I believe this is where we miss it. I mean, all of us. We let circumstances dictate our obedience. We let circumstances dictate our level of obedience. I've stopped trying to figure it out. And let me just help you, just in the area of giving. And I'm not, look, I'm teaching you. I have learned that it's a It is much easier to obey God if I do it quickly. Because then I don't have the time. Every one of us has had that. God speaks to us to do something, and then we let time go by, and we reason out why it wasn't God. And this is my favorite explanation from, quote, faith people. You know, God will tell you to do something, tell you to give something away, and then you go, okay, God, I'll do it. And then a couple days go by, and you've reasoned out how it's not God, and you'll say, God was just testing me, and I passed that test. No, you didn't pass that test till you released it. You know, I could tell you, oh, I'm telling you what, every Sunday I give my motorcycles away. And then God tells me Sunday night, no, 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 son, I just wanted to see if you would or not. There's no blessing from what you intend to do.
No.
That's like the farmer saying, going out in the field with his seed and then coming back with it and saying, see, God, I would. But most of the church world, that's where they live.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I would, God, I would go anywhere you tell me to go. But that's too far. I'll do whatever you tell me to do, God, but not that. You don't walk into blessing that way. And so verse 7 says, it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land. Love it, I always like to bring this out. Verse 8, this is rich. Verse 8 comes after verse 7. You want me to say that again?
Yeah.
Okay. Then the word of the Lord came to him. See, I think we missed that. The way that God had been sustaining him had dried up, but he didn't move until the word of the Lord came to him. How many times have we missed it because we jumped at what we thought was a good idea? God hadn't said anything yet. And then the word of the Lord came to him, told him to go to the widow's house. And God, and he didn't let the circumstances at the widow's house dictate to him the outcome either. I mean, he gets there and she says, I got enough left to make one more cake and I'm going to die. I mean, we're a positive woman. But I love that because Elijah had learned how to work the blessing for himself. Now God sent him to a family to work it. Beloved, before we ever started pastoring here, God had us learning how to operate the blessing for just us. I can't teach it to you. I can't let the blessing work in your life, or I can't teach you how to have the blessing work in your life if it's not working in mine. I mean, would you want to listen to me if I got up this morning and said, you know what, I want to teach you about the blessing. I have never seen it work. I don't even know if it works, but I'm going to tell you what the word says.
No.
I want to hear somebody that says, you know what, this stuff works, and here's an example. This stuff works, and here's an example. This stuff works, and here's an example. Well, that sounds like you're bragging, Pastor. Yeah.
Amen.
I'm bragging on God. I'm bragging on the blessing. It works. Okay. Verse 15. We'll finish it here. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 15. Do you remember God sent him to the widow's house? She had enough to make one more cake. He says, make it for me first. Now, be honest with me. How many of us, that would have been a difficult command to obey? I'm going to tell you, as a pastor, with a pastor's heart, to tell somebody, take the last that you have and give it to me. It's not easy. I can't tell you how many times I've had people come, and it may be a handful of change. It may be a bag of change. It may be, you know, I've had little kids bring their piggy banks. And you're like, oh, God, oh, my. And if I cared what people thought about me, I would never receive that. Look at him taking money from kids. What kind of filthy lucre? That's what that is. It's filthy lucre. No. Filthy lucre is when you've connived to get the money.
Yeah.
This Elijah goes to this widow's house and knows if she doesn't bring the seed, if she doesn't obey God, she will get exactly what she said and she's going to die. And so he tells her, can you imagine how difficult it is for him and how difficult it is for her to take her last meal and give it away? And I love verse 15. So she went and did according to the word of Elijah. Let me ask you, and I know you know the answer, what would have happened if she disobeyed?
She'd
She would have died.
What kind of God would let her die?
A God that wants obedience. That's like me standing at the door with a huge umbrella to walk you to your car, and it's a downpour, and you say, I don't want to walk that way, Pastor. And then you're mad at me because you're getting wet. That's exactly what happens. And so she went and did the word of Elijah, and she and her household did eat for many days. The bowl of flour was not exhausted, nor did the jar of oil become empty, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke through Elijah. One more verse. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse number 1. And it shall be, if you diligently obey the Lord your God. It's not just obeying God, it's diligent. Isaiah said it this way, if you're willing
and obedient,
you'll eat the good of the land. Maybe if you're not eating the good of the land, you might want to check one of those two areas. Am I willing? Am I obedient? He says, if you diligently obey the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, which I command you today, the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. All these blessings will come upon you and overtake you if. It's a key word. We don't like it. If. It is a conditional promise. Well, I'm blessed because I'm a Christian. Oh, you are. Your sins are forgiven. But you want to walk in the blessing? You can. And beloved, these aren't all the scriptures on it. If you obey God. Well, I'll obey him up until. That's not obedience. I preached years ago. I'm dogmatic about divine order. If when people ask me, you know, how beloved, I haven't fallen into sin. 25 years in the ministry, 30, I've never walked away from God. I haven't fallen off into sin. God hadn't gotten off in my doctrine. And the number one reason I haven't is because I stay submitted. I have somebody that speaks into my life, and if they speak something into my life, I'm going to heed what they have to say. This trip to Angola, Wednesday, I went to Pastor. This is how I presented it to him. I said, Pastor, you know, this person called me. They invited me to come to Angola. I don't want to go. And I'm asking you to pray. And I'll do whatever you tell me to do. And I can be totally honest. I would. I said, I'll do whatever you tell me to do. And but I'm telling you, I don't want to go. But I want to obey God. And so, about 3 days later, I came back to him and I said, have you heard anything? He said, Jim, you pray. You tell me what God's saying. And I'll back you. And so I did.